Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Ground Floor Academy video series. Today, I have the pleasure of welcoming Michael Pozniak from Prince Edward Island, Canada. Michael's going to be talking to us today about different angles of real estate investing in real estate, specifically on the commercial part of real estate and real estate investing in apartments. Michael's been involved with the industry for a very long time, has a great setup on the island in Charlottetown, and we're going to be kind of diving into the details with that. So for those of you who don't know, my name is Tony Ablon. I'm the founder of the Ground Floor Academy and also the founder of Ground Floor Property Management here in Moncton, New Brunswick, Canada. So this series, this video series that we're putting together is for mostly for new real estate investors or for anybody out there looking to learn a little bit more about how to get into real estate and how to effectively get into the rental market. So without further ado, we'll let Michael give us a quick intro. Michael.
Hey, Tony, thanks very much for inviting me on my first live webinar. Hopefully we don't make any mistakes. And if we do, you said you could edit them out afterwards. Absolutely. For the YouTube version. But yes. Tony's great. His company, Ground Floor Property Management, has been doing amazing things in Atlantic Canada, and now they're going to take over the province of Prince Edward Island.
That's the hopes. You bet.
My background is I've been a full-time agent in Prince Edward Island for closer to almost 19 years now. Too many years. And in PEI, you can't really do commercial real estate 100%, but I've been involved in a number of commercial transactions from $0 into the multi-millions, both in PEI and in other provinces. So that's my spiel. I work out of Charlottetown and Summerside and try to cover the island from end to end. And I think apartments are probably one of the best investments out there. And the banking system will tell us that by believing and investing in them with us.
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely agree. What's the, just out of curiosity, what's been the, I don't know if you know this offhand, but you probably would, the population change in the island, like within the last, let's say, 5 or 10 years? Are we seeing an influx? I know New Brunswick, for a period of time, we had a huge, a lot of people obviously move out west to Alberta following the oil and for jobs and all that sort. Has PEI had a larger influx of people going out or coming in? Kind of what have you seen some trends out there?
I think the demographics for New Brunswick, Nova Scotia, and PEI are fairly similar and to a more minimal amount right across the entire country. I mean, the population's getting older.
Yep.
People are going to go where the jobs are. Some of them have moved out west. The oil, you know, per barrel dollar value has gone down. So now some of them are coming back or they're going to BC.
Yep.
We've got some big construction projects coming up in PEI. So I hear, and in Nova Scotia with different shopping malls and that going in. Boat building in Halifax. So things are actually pretty good, pretty consistent in the Atlantic provinces. They're not... You know, you're not buying into a bubble like Alberta where a house is going to go from 70 to 450 and back down to 85. Right? So I think it's a great place to invest. And the differences between us and the West Coast is West Coast, a lot of people are buying just to get into the country and use them as immigration tools. And it's also because of its proximity to Asia.
Yes.
And of course, when Hong Kong was taken back by the Chinese, that was a huge threat. Yep. So you saw a lot of people buying commercial properties on the West Coast that made no sense monetarily, which blew the cap rates or the, you know, it basically made the commercial product not really all that viable. The further east you went, the more viability you saw. And in the Atlantic provinces, it's not difficult to see 6, 10, maybe 35% return on your money.
Yep. Yeah, that's point on. I had a great discussion with a gentleman from Ontario. I know from BC yesterday, he again kind of reflected the same message in terms of he can no longer buy out there. He has, the market has become impossible for, he's not a new investor. You know, he's owned real estate in multi-units for many years and the market has just become so outpriced that he's now looking at the Maritimes to invest and specifically in Moncton and in Charlottetown. Looking at buying some multi-units and the price per door, obviously in the return is key, right? They can afford to come in here and buy a 6 unit for, you know, 200,000, 300,000, 400,000 or a 12 18 unit under $1 million, right? You're seeing in some spots. So very, very good entry points for these guys.
Yeah, no, absolutely. The challenge is finding somebody that can find you the product.
Yep.
There's buyers out there. You know, I was looking at a portfolio the other week there. I mean, it was $22 million portfolio, several hundred units, but trying to pry it out of their hands to sell it is another thing. So the product that is out there and it's good usually gets scooped up right away if you've got qualified buyers working with you.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. So folks, for everybody listening, one of the focuses that I really want to be able to bring out with Michael is we've all probably learned and know about the importance of assembling a great power team when you're a real estate investor. And two of the most important people to be part of that puzzle is typically your realtor and, of course, property management. Property managers, I think, are probably one of the biggest assets to a real estate investor, but also the realtors involved, right? You know, these are the guys on the ground that are finding deals. And I think Michael's going to provide a lot of value here and good tips to how to work with a realtor successfully and to make sure that that you're, you know, as an investor coming in and trying to build these relationships with these realtors, you got to do it, you know, at a certain level and take it very seriously and kind of do it in a professional manner. And I think Mike's going to have a lot of great information with that. Before we jump into that, we always traditionally start with our first property. Michael is not only a realtor and kind of deals with commercial real estate, he's also an investor himself. So, Michael, I'd love for you to share with us your first experience with a multi-unit, your first buy. Maybe it was a single family or it was an apartment building, I don't know. And maybe before you jump into the purchase, tell us a little bit about how real estate became something you wanted to be involved with, whether from an educational standpoint, maybe it was something, a family-driven type business, or how did you get into real estate and how did you get that first buy?
Okay, first of all, I was looking for a pen here, and of course, I have 10 of them, but they're all hidden under stacks of paper. Your comments in regards to the team and the property management, I'm not going to go on a lot about that, but that has been a huge issue here in PEI. I'm sure it's been a huge issue everywhere else.
Yep.
It's one thing to sell somebody an apartment, but it's another thing to have it managed properly. And I've seen time after time after time again where people will buy apartments, they'll buy portfolios, and they know absolutely nothing about managing them. Yep. So they take it upon themselves, they run into issues, and 3 or 4 years later, they're back on the market.
Yep.
Having a proper management team, specifically or more so the property manager in place, is hugely important.
Yep.
Property management in Prince Edward Island, and you can tell me what it's like in New Brunswick, but I mean, you know, your average property manager here is typically being someone that's retired, looking for something to do. I had a call yesterday from a girl that's been in the cleaning business, and she wanted to get into property management. I'm a huge proponent on education. If and that's something I do every day. Every day I'm on learning seminars. I'm always flying all over North America taking training courses.
Yep.
Be a better real estate agent.
Yep.
And work better with investors. But it's important to have a proper property management team in place, because they're going to make you money just like the agent's going to make you money.
Yep.
Do you agree?
Yeah. Jeez, you're taking the words right out of my mouth. Too many. You know, it's in so many different markets where I have a with realtors, unfortunately. You see a lot of realtors out there that may or may not be very busy on the sales side, so they tend to put their feet into property management as a side business to try to make up on the income. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm sure there's plenty of realtors that can do this. They do it very well, and they do a great job for the investors. But as a whole, as an entity, from what I've seen, whether if it's in North America, Canada, the U.S., it doesn't matter, I've heard a lot more horror stories from that type of setup than the other. The reason being is the reality is the sales business is a lot sexier than property management. And when somebody's managing a property and they get lured by, you know, a $50,000 commission coming in from the sale of an apartment building or a piece of property, it's going to take their focus away from probably the day-to-day requirements of running and growing a management business. So That's why personally, I've always saw the marriage of a realtor and property management as being somewhat of a conflict. And that's why personally, I've never gotten my real estate license. People tell me I'm crazy. They should say, I hear it all the time. You should be licensed. You'd be selling this stuff all over the place. I'm like, well, that's not what I'm looking to do. I'm looking to grow my management business. If there's sales opportunities, I'm a connector. I'll connect it with the good agents that I want to deal with. And at the end of the day, I'm looking to get the management of the building. I know there's a lot of money to be made, but I know there's also a lot of money to be made if I do this management thing right. And that's kind of a focus we've taken.
Yeah, and the other advantage to what you're doing, we're not going to get the business structure. It's more residual. There's people that are selling. They're always out trying to sell, which, of course, when you take their focus away from property management, I mean, 90% of my time is spent trying to promote properties and getting them sold. With respect to what you said about focus and conflict of interest, very, very important. We've had agents that were doing property management on the side, and we've had property managers that were licensed as agents. And they always had the same problem. It was a conflict of interest, right? Because they're thinking, well, you're selling me this building so you can manage it, or you're managing this building so you can sell it, or you're managing it so you can get the listing so you can sell it. Now that they've transitioned to property managers, and only property managers, they're doing a lot better. My background is I've been involved with real estate since I was probably tall enough to reach a file cabinet. Mother, as a kid, used to clean real estate offices part-time, and of course, I'd be in the back looking at all the listings.
Nice.
In my neighborhood, we used to have a real estate agent. He was with Century 21 at the time. Back then, when you had the gold jacket and the Cadillac that was 35 feet long with the horns on the front, of course, things have changed a lot since then. We've got mirrors that are only 10 feet long with the horns on the front. But I've always been interested in real estate in different aspects of it. When I came to Prince Edward Island in 97, about 6 months after the Confederation Bridge was put in, I attempted to do what I did in Ontario, which was information technology and computers. I used to set up offices, manufacturing plants, hundreds of accounting offices. We had hundreds of medical offices. I was involved in setting up originally what is referred to today as ICI World, which Gary Nesca runs. You may know Gary. He's in Toronto. ICIworld.net, I think it is. It's the second largest commercial real estate site in Canada. I started that, you know, I was working for him. And we started that with dial-up modems in about 30 years ago. Long time ago. So that's still running. So I've always been involved in commercial. I've always had an interest in residential. When I came to PEI, the computer technology stuff, it just couldn't work here. It's just not enough businesses, too much ground to cover. So I took my license and started in real estate and PEI, and fell on my face 1,000 times and eventually became good at it. And I did some commercial deals, including a number of shopping malls and apartments and different stuff, raw land, subdivisions I've done. Just anything. I'm eager to learn, and I think if you surround yourself with the right people and admit that you don't know everything, you'll do well. And I think that's that's the main thing. It's like managing an apartment. I mean, I can do plumbing all day long. I've got the scars to prove it on my arm, but I'm not really good at it. It probably would have been better to spend the $50 and burn my arm twice trying to change a faucet, right?
That's very interesting. I guess that in a market of your size, and even if you look at the entire island, you got to know kind of a little bit about everything in that to be able to survive in that market. Just being focused on, like I said earlier, about you probably couldn't make a living if you're just a commercial guy, or is that changing?
In PEI, you can't really make a living doing 100% commercial. There's a few exceptions. And we do now have a 100% commercial brokerage, and I wish them the absolute best. They'll do well, the leadership that they have. When I was focusing more on commercial, I was focused on commercial right across the states and Canada. Primarily, my primary interest at that point was hotels, because again, you specialize in one thing, you'll do well at it. You can't do a hotel, a motel, a a variety store, shopping center, an apartment and expect to do well at it. And the people that do well at things usually focus on one thing. But the fact of, you know, spending 99% of your time flying all over the country is not really, didn't really inspire me. I think if you're going to do a commercial real estate 100% of the time, you ought to move to somewhere that has a viable commercial base, and it's probably not in Atlantic Canada. There's right. just not enough product. Anytime I've had people that have come to PEI looking for big product, I'll usually refer them to another state or another province, depending on mm-hmm. The dollar value at the time, right? Because dollars right. can be leveraged as well, right? Right yeah. now, if you're an American buyer, you're getting a 30-40% discount. So even if you buy the property at 20% over market, you're still getting a discount, right? Which is really exciting. Absolutely. This year is going to be awesome just because of that as well, right?
Yep, for sure. That's good. Okay, so tell us about your first purchase. How did you get that first deal? And what was
first
it?
First apartment purchase? Or, okay.
First real estate, not your, as an investment, not your first home, but your first investment property.
There's been a few. Probably the two more significant ones is I've done a subdivision with raw land, and I've also done a smaller apartment with 11 units. So I don't know what okay. direction you want to go in there. I mean, I've done a lot of subdivisions for myself and clients.
Okay.
That's pretty straightforward and easy to do.
Yeah.
Do you want me to go down the land of, do you want me to go down the road of raw land first?
Let's do the 11 unit.
Okay. What happened is I had my eye on a particular 11-unit apartment building. It had been on the market for some time, but it was never listed on MLS. It was never marketed.
Yeah.
The biggest challenge with apartment buildings I find is there's this belief that if the vendor or the owner, we usually call them a vendor, decides to sell the building and publicize that on MLS, they feel that the tenants are going to leave. And I've never seen any evidence of whatsoever of that. I've seen buildings flip 3 and 4 times and never seen a single tenant leave unless it's as a result of poor management. So I don't understand this fear to market an apartment, because what happens, and what happens a lot of times, and I'm not saying this specifically about this purchase here, but a lot of times you're getting less dollars for that unit or that apartment building because it's not being marketed. Which is great for a buyer. You know, the buyer looks at that and says, hey, here's a hidden gem, never been marketed. The owner's been trying to sell it for 5 years, but the price is from 5 years ago. It's never been raised. And of course, the owner thinks it's a result of there not being a buyer, when the fact is it's never been marketed. The way I bought that unit is I basically went into the bank, or in this case, a credit union, and I said, I want to buy this unit. It's, I don't know, it was like 100. Do you want prices and numbers and
sure.
stuff?
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's about $1 million building. And I told the bank I wanted to buy it with zero money down. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to use another property I had as equity.
Yep.
As I was sitting there on this other property, which was a community or building lots, rail acreage, stuff like that, some other stuff.
Yep.
And I said, here's your security, because it's free, clear, there's no mortgage on it.
Yep.
So I want to take that, I want to put a charge against it or a mortgage, basically saying, you know, if we sell that property, they have rights to a percentage of that money coming in from that property or properties until we get our 20% or 30% down, whatever they wanted in their pocket. And then they would release the charge on the first property. I don't know if you're following along here. I probably need to draw a chart here, but I don't have a pen.
No, that's good.
But essentially the bottom line is, if you have equity, and you see this particularly in people that are older, they'll own a house or two or three houses. They're all paid for. They're on a duplex and three houses. And they're not utilizing the equity they have in those properties, because you can go to the bank, even if you have a $200,000 house, and say, listen, I want to buy this duplex for 100 and a half, I don't want to put any money down. And they'll just charge that other property. In some cases, some of the banks I've dealt with, they'll want to take some of the equity out of the first property and put it into the second as a down payment. I've seen that as well.
Yep.
So that's how you buy money, or that's how you buy properties with no money down. The idea being is this 11 unit, you know, 3-4 years later, the value has gone up. The mortgage has been paid off to a point. So now the charge on the first property can be relinquished. So now it's free and clear again. So then I can go to the bank and say, hey, I want to buy another property with zero money down. And they're like, okay, sounds good. Yeah. You've done well in the first, second, third one. Let's go out and buy another. But of course, the challenge is always finding the product, right? It's hard to find nice, clean product. And of course, the other reason is, like I said, initially, nobody wants to say it's for sale because they're afraid their tenants are going to leave. So leveraging, the bottom line, leveraging equity you already have, whether it's on a large scale or even a small scale, is a great thing to do. There's a lot of seniors out there that don't have retirement programs, yet they're sitting on a house that could generate hundreds, if not thousands of dollars a month in income. Do you agree?
Absolutely. You brought up two fantastic points here, Michael. I'm going to speak to the first one. The fear of tenants moving when they hear that an owner is going to be selling. I also hear that. I still hear it to this day. It's most often from an old school landlord, meaning it's typically from probably an older gentleman that's had an apartment building, perhaps in the family, or they've had it, they built it, and it's, you know, they've had it for 20, 30, 40 years. They've developed relationships with all the tenants. Everybody knows them by name. They know everything about, you know, the families and everything like that. I often hear that when we're faced with situations like that. I find that newer buyers, they don't even think twice, right? Especially if it's a commercial building, six units or up. You know, buy and sell has, you know, the tenants are usually never affected, but when I work with these older property owners, they have that. It's like a different level of care, you know, that they've put into the property, that they know everybody personally, and they're scared that, oh no, you know, something's going to happen. So I see that a lot. I don't know if that makes sense to you, but.
Well, you know better than me, but it makes absolute perfect sense. And I did have an experience with an apartment building I purchased that had exactly that. The owner lived, you know, six doors down the street, and he was there 15 times a day. Every time he showed up, all the tenants would be poking their heads out of their holes like a bunch of gophers. And I got a light bulb here, and this tap is leaking, and there's a speck of dust on this wall. And when I inherited the property, of course, I tried to be Joe Perfect Property Manager, and I realized after a short time that it's best never to be there. Because every time I showed up, they would give me a list of things, and they would, in my opinion, I don't know if it's trying to take advantage of me or because of the previous owner catered to them, like a 5-star hotel with concierge service.
Yes.
It was starting to turn into more of what you were talking about.
Yep.
And at that point, I basically had to change the way I did things. And I only show up when I wear a disguise late at night. If I not really, but I've said a few things straight. And now what we do is when we get these lists of items that they want fixed that are non-urgent. For instance, you know, they'll have like a cracked plastic downspout or something. Yeah. We do it all in the spring. We get it done, and we say, you know, next year we'll do it again. They'll have like a rusty sink, stuff that's doesn't have to be fixed immediately.
Right.
Anything that has to be fixed immediately, I have people that can do that, and I think property managers are key to that. So I've gotten away from a lot of that micromanaging because my time can be spent doing other things other than fixing things. And
absolutely,
what it takes me all day to do, a professional that's in the plumbing business, the electrical business, can do in 2 minutes because he's got all the tools. He's got all the stuff in his truck. I got to drive into town. You know, do you have this faucet? And, oh, no, we don't have it. Check Kent, your home hardware. It turns into a half a day when I can spend my time trying to sell my sell my listings rather than managing property. So again, the endorsement's on the property management.
Absolutely. I agree. The other point that you brought up is leveraging equity. I just got back, I think I mentioned that to you, that I just got back from a big real estate conference in Toronto, the Wealth Canadian Wealth Forum. And the hot topic of the forum was how to raise money. You know, every real estate investor, that's kind of the first question that they want to talk about is how to raise money, how do you get into deals with no money down, how to structure JV, joint venture deals with other investors. So you kind of hit a key point to where there's a ton of people out there sitting on a boatload of equity in their, usually on their first homes. People that have owned houses more than 10, 15, 20 years, either their homes are paid off or they're getting pretty close if they haven't continuously financed and pulled equity out. And a lot of people, I would say the majority, just sit on that money and never do anything with it. When it's really, it's money that could be put to use, whether if it's buying real estate, if they don't want to be that active in a deal, they could be partnering up with other investors that are looking for private money to invest in different types of deals. But absolutely, as a consensus, I think there's a lot of people out there that are not taking advantage of the equity that's available into their personal homes. And typically how that would work for anybody that's kind of watching this is usually what happens is if you have a home and you have, let's say, $200,000 worth of equity in it, every major bank has programs. You hear the term HELOC. In different terms to where you can take out a secured line of credit against the house. So if you want to take out, if you have $200,000 in equity, you could probably easily take out, you know, $50,000 to $100,000 of equity in terms of a line of credit and then either, you know, use it yourself to go out and buy something. You can use that money as a down payment to go out and buy an apartment building or provide to an investor to go out and buy properties and kind of be the expert part of that formula. And I think even RSP money, you see that a lot today, right? It's getting more and more popular. A lot of people didn't know that you can take your RSP money and use that to fund mortgages, right? There's different organizations out there that structure these types of deals. And there's a ton of investors or real estate professionals out there looking for private money. And a lot of them get it through RSPs. Because a lot of people, again, they're not necessarily happy with whether if they're in the stock market or they're just in mutual funds or in GICs, being able to use that RSP money to fund real estate is very viable, and a lot of people are doing. I don't know if you've had any experience with that, Michael.
RSPs are an absolute great thing to utilize for investment properties. I always thought of an RSP as sort of a bet on failure in life. And what I mean by that is that they tell you that, you know, save your money, put it in an RSP, you know, take percentage of your earnings, put it in an RSP. When you're old and decrepit and broke, you'll be able to draw it out at a lower tax bracket. I'm thinking, you know, my plan is not to end up broke when I'm 60, 70 years old, right? So I can be paying more tax on this money. Regardless of that, that's the educational system is sort of promoted. That's what the bank is promoted, obviously, because they're making money on it. Every dollar they bring in, they probably make three off of.
Absolutely.
I think you got a great idea. Pull it out, put it into real estate. You can hold that real estate. Again, I'm not a CA or a CPA, I guess it's converting over to. And you should always, you know, that's an important part of your team that I touch on that is hire a good accountant with knowledge of apartment buildings. A lot of accountants, I mean, I've had accountants before, they owned no real estate and they're leasing their premises and renting it. This is probably not the guy you want to deal with. The guy you want to deal with is the guy that's investing in real estate and that's active. With respect to RSPs, in the States, they have an IRA or whatever it's called. Again, I'm not a U.S. accountant. But there are vehicles for Americans to buy properties in Canada through certain vehicles so they can buy out of their retirement savings as well. And I don't think a lot of U.S. buyers realize this. The biggest challenge I find with finance period is that, you know, my experience, I've got a lot of experience in finance and stocks and bonds and options and futures I've traded. there's like 20 different words for every one thing. And you touched on HILOC, and, you know, they talk about floating loans and interbank lending, LIBOR rates. And I mean, it's like they go out of their way to make it complicated. And it's not. The biggest challenge with people buying real estate, whether it's just buying their first home or their third home or an apartment building, is they don't present things properly, and they don't shop around. And what I always suggest, and what I've always done when buying commercial properties, is I'll just grab a loan application from the Bank of Montreal or TD or Scotia. It doesn't matter. They're all the same. They just want to know income, expense, assets, liabilities. Fill that out. I go a step further, and some people can't do this, but I'll get a copy of my real credit report, the one the bank sees, not the one you get online for free. And I'll put that with it. I'll tell them not to run it until I get approval, because every time it's ran, there's a minimum little tick there. Plus, banks will go in there and they'll say, oh, he's been at the TD. Well, we know what the TD is going to offer, and we'll offer him this, and he's been at BMO. I prepare a complete financial package on me, my assets. I put it in a binder. I did one once. I mean, it had extensive documentation on a DVD. I hand it out to five lenders typically. I typically look at credit unions, a couple credit unions, two or three banks. The difference between a credit union and a bank is a bank, they share their money, their pool of money across the entire country or infrastructure. Whereas a credit union, you deal with a credit union that's in one town. It may be completely different from the credit union in another town because, you know, A may have a bunch of money they want to lend out. B doesn't have any money to lend out. So just like shopping for a TV, if I go to four or five or six different lenders and I tell them I'm doing this so they know they're competing, out of that six, I'm typically going to get one that's really easy to deal with. And I'm probably going to get four that are really a nuisance to deal with. I mean, you have no idea some of the things I've been through. I mean, you know, they're asking for information that you just can't produce, you know, they're telling you they don't want your business. So I shop the package. I know what my information is. And the other thing is I completely understand the idea of having to invest money in due diligence. If I have to spend $1,000 on a survey or $500 on a plot plan or have a study drawn up or whatever it takes to do that, I will do it. And they don't all go together. I mean, I've spent money in the last few months on inspections that failed. But better to have an inspection that fails and a deal not go through than find out I've got an apartment building that's filled with Kitech plumbing that's all going to explode one day, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm sorry about going in five different directions, but
no. I think you brought up another key point, and it's funny because it's come up in almost every conversation that we've had so far in the academy in the series. Is the importance of this investor binder and dealing with financial institutions, banks, all these guys that's going to be, you know, the provider of the money. The difference, if you can walk into a bank with a professionally packaged investor binder that has, you know, all of your details with regards to your, you know, your last 2 years, NOAs, T1 generals, all of your assets, your liabilities, details on the property that you're looking to buy, kind of a little bio and a resume for yourself and why you're good for this deal and why this deal is good for you. All these things, it's when you present this to a banker, they're just absolutely blown away. And the feedback, I know we've done it when we purchase our properties. We bought two fourplexes probably about five or six years ago. And basically I went to went to the office, dropped off my binder for myself and my partner. And the next day we were approved. And he called me up and he said, I never seen anything like that before. He's like, you had everything ready to go. I didn't have to call you to ask you any more questions to slow things down. And the bank was just blown away. They're like, yeah, these are the types of guys that we want to partner with and we want to invest with. Right. You differentiate yourself so much from the amateurs out there that it just changes the game for you.
And if I may, if you can't do it for yourself, find someone that can do it for you. You know,
yeah.
Yeah. It's just like sort of the saying that if you if you're representing yourself in court, you have a fool for a client. Admit what you can do well and you can't do well. I mean, I love woodworking. I probably wouldn't do it all day because I'd probably have less fingers. So I will hire someone that knows what they're doing. Yep. The one thing I didn't mention is, you know, when you're talking lending and borrowing money, I mean, there's a bunch of different tools. Really, you need to have a lot of training on raising capital. I mean, there's ways a lot of bigger companies raise capital through REITs, real estate investment trusts, public companies. But those are kind of down the road from the average investor because they're very expensive to set up and the regulations are very controlling. But, you know, down the road to have a webinar on group investing, you know, if you have five people with X number of dollars a piece, you can probably put together a lot more deals than you can on your by yourself. And of course, absolutely, I'm always of the belief I'd rather have a percentage of something than 100% of nothing. I just want to touch on a deal I did last year.
Sure.
I did a deal last year without getting into any specific information. It was a commercial deal. Mm-hmm. It was fairly significant. And we were all ready to go. We had the financing in place. Everything was great until the purchaser decided to sell everything he owned in another province, moved to PEI, and quit his job. So, of course, you know what happened there, right?
Yeah.
The bank said, where's this income you put on your application? Where are these jobs? Well, I've quit them and I've sold the house. So they ended up moving here. And you know, I mentioned credit unions and banks, but one of the most powerful tools I've used in the past, and again, we used it a couple weeks ago when we had two banks pull financing on a deal. I use a commercial, and actually does residential as well, mortgage broker. And this guy is absolutely amazing. And in reference to the scenario I told you about, I mean, he drove to New Brunswick. He met with private lenders in person. He got the purchasers jobs. Like, this guy is incredible. I mean, never underestimate a mortgage broker. A lot of times they can get you better deals than you're going to get at the bank because of the volume they're doing. And the other thing they have access to that the banks and the credit unions typically do not is private funds. There's a lot of people out there looking to get out of the stock market because of the volatility, right? You know, their stock's worth $100 one day, it's worth 20 the next, 101 down to 83. You know, Apple did great until I bought it a couple of years ago. And now it's now look where it is, right? But the package, the presentation is by far the most most powerful thing you can do. And I do it in listing presentations on listing properties. I don't tell somebody what the stats are. I show them on a chart or a spreadsheet. People are like 80 to 90% visual. So if you can visualize to the lender what you've done, what you're doing, show them a picture of that apartment and how nice it is. Because you may be saying, I own an apartment, or you mentioned a couple fourplexes or whatever it was. I could envision, like, I was envisioning like a 50-year-old building with wood siding, and it could be a brand new brick building built 3 months ago, right? So the package is absolutely everything. The mortgage broker, one of the reasons I brought him up is he says his biggest challenge is just getting the information he asks for.
Absolutely. It's always the challenge. Chasing. Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm actually going through a deal right now where I'm refinancing my property and a few other properties. And again, it's in terms of, okay, here's everything. And I've taken it upon myself to try to minimize the work that he has to do to get me a deal, right? As an investor, I take it very seriously that my job is to make his job as easy as it can be, right? Because at the end of the day, I want an approval, right? I don't want him to be frustrated because he's working with me or not wanting to answer my emails or not wanting to answer my calls. I want him to look forward to working with me because he knows that he's going to get everything sent to him on a silver platter, and it's hopefully going to be an easy deal for him, right?
And that's what he wants, and it's the same. Yeah. You know, we were talking earlier about agents and people going up to commercial agents or even residential agents and say, hey, you know, if you have that building, I'd love to go through it.
Yeah.
And right away, you're, as an agent, I'm thinking, like, you're not probably not very experienced at buying commercial properties, because the last thing you do is you go through a commercial property. The first thing you do is you look at the numbers.
Yeah.
And you see if they make sense. And then you do a lot of due diligence. Probably the last thing you do is go through it, whereas a residential buyer might be completely opposite. You know, 96% of them will drive by it or drive by it on Google Street View, and then they'll go through. Well, with an apartment, it's so much more about rent rolls and income and expenses and taxes, condition of the building, location, demographics, you know, how long have the tenants been in there? How old are they? What's their income streams? Like, there's a million different things you want to concern yourself about before you're contacting agents trying to set up a half a day showing on a 20 unit apartment building.
Yep. I got two things that I like to talk about this, and this is kind of the meat of the discussion that I want to go through. So yesterday I had a gentleman, I think I mentioned a while ago, I had a gentleman call me from BC. I could tell he's an experienced investor. He, you know, before we even got started in discussing anything about properties, he gave me kind of a complete bio of his history, of what he's looking to buy, what he's purchased in the past, what his financial situation is. And the guy sounded, you know, made him sound, you know, very polished, and that he knew exactly what he was doing. And kind of at the end of the discussion, I kind of walked away and I'm like, you know, wow, this guy, he's doing it right. He's basically, he's from BC, so he's looking at investing in the East Coast, so he's fairly far away. His first priority is to create the relationships that he needs to build his portfolio. So his first call was out to a property manager. He then asked me for various realtors that knew multi-units in the area. So I then provided him with, you know, my kind of top three or four contacts that that I would have anything to do with. And I also gave him a few other referrals to kind of who he can feel out. He had already done research in terms of the statistics for the areas in Moncton and in Charlottetown, to be specific. Demographics, unemployment, vacancy rates. He knew all this stuff down pat. And I was like, wow, you know, this guy's done his homework. So it's exactly like you said. It's when you're looking at an apartment building, you're in the multi-unit phase. You don't just call up a realtor and say, I want to go see this building. Typically there's, you know, researching the area, making sure you have kind of a team assembled is a good thing to kind of get started out of the gate. Then the first thing you ask for numbers, right? Send me the pro forma of the building. And I think on the other side of that, what I don't see, and I wish I would see more of, is realtors when they list apartment buildings to have pro formas done up properly, professionally, and not handwritten and scanned in an email and that you can half see. That's a huge pet peeve of mine when I get these pro formas from different people out there. Whether it could be from realtors or it could be private sales through the investors and the owners themselves, but I think it's crucial from the investor standpoint to kind of do his due diligence, be a professional, and also from the realtor side of the table to have a professional package, knowing that the first call is not going to be for a showing. There's going to be a lot of discussions involved, and the investors are going to look for numbers. That's the first stage.
You tipped off on something that absolutely drives me crazy, and that's people listing commercial properties with agents that have absolutely no commercial experience whatsoever. I wish they would at least partner with somebody that did have commercial experience, because when I'm looking at a commercial property, I'm looking at it as a commercial investor, not looking at it as a residential home buyer that says, oh, it's pretty, it has a nice driveway and a roof. The numbers are absolutely everything. I want to talk about performas, but before I do, the financial information I get a lot of times on these apartments, like they'll send me the profit and loss for the last 3 years or whatever, and it's just crap. I mean, what I want is I want EBITDA financials. I want financials that are less amortization, bank loans. I've had them involve leases on boats and cars and student loans and all kinds of different stuff. I want EBITDA financials. I just want to see income, expense. I can figure out my own vacancy rates. I can figure out, you know, your typical you know, being in the business, you know what your management costs are going to be, and maintenance, 30-40%, whatever the standard is. Yep. With reference to pro formas, like, I don't know how you define a pro forma. The pro forma to me is how that property or that commercial entity is going to perform in the future. And right. one of the reasons I look at property managers and people like yourself that are doing a phenomenal job is I want you to do the pro forma. Yep. I want to take that building, and maybe your definitions of pro forma are different, but I want to take that building that really isn't performing at all because half of it's empty. I went through one there the other day that had two unit apartments. I think they're each like 10,000 square feet. You got one person living in them. I want you to take that building and say, well, we can cut these units. We can, this is what the rent's going to be. We're going to convert the commercial into residential. That's what I look at as a pro forma. The pro forma right. based on the current financials may not be that good, but the pro forma that you can produce as a management company can make that building look awesome. And I think that's another advantage of hiring a property manager.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, I guess I should have used more the term analysis. What the current analysis, I call them a trailing 12, trailing 24. Yep. Basically the exact, I see it all the time with different brokerages here in town. They will not, like they'll put in for apartment repairs, landscaping, and various things. They'll put some, like, I'll look at a 12 unit building and they'll say landscaping, $1,200 for the year. And I'm like, well, I know that's crap, because it's, first of all, what landscaping is going to be exactly $1,200. So that tells me that they're not pulling from the raw data, from the exact right. data.
It's called the believability of numbers.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah. It always comes back to, okay, you know, I'll see these numbers and I'm like, okay, you know, if this is around where it is, that's fine. But I'll always have to revert back. Okay, send me the last, you know, 12 months of actual power bills. I want to see the actual, you know, payments for insurance. I want to see the actuals of what the landscaping costs, the garbage removal, the maintenance repairs and all that stuff, right? The real numbers. So I've always been the guy that I'd rather see the real stuff up front when they put the analysis together. That way I don't have to go chasing for more information later, kind of like in the mortgage broker situation, right?
Yeah, and that, again, that goes back to if the property is listed or it's offered through an agent. That goes back to trying to ascertain this information. Yeah. And it's a lot easier if, and you probably have this, you seem very organized, a checklist to give the vendor and say, this is what I need. I need your electrical bills. I need to see your insurance. I need to know what your insurance covers. Does that insurance include general liability for a corporation? Because a lot of these apartments, you can't get insurance unless you have general liability. Mm-hmm. So they're
great.
To try to break down those financials. The other thing is leases, tenants, rent roll, configuration of the apartments.
Oh, God. Yeah.
It's probably better than the 3 or 1. We both know why, right?
Yeah. It's crazy. And that's where the inexperience, if you're working with a realtor that doesn't have the multi-unit experience, really, really comes through. I dealt with a guy the other day, a realtor in town, and, you know, we're talking about, and I said, you know, can you send me the rent roll? No idea what that was. Never heard the term rent roll before. And right. I was like, oh boy, this is going to be painful.
And just stopping there for half a second, like, let's assume that you don't have your act together. All your financials are written on the back of a napkin. Yep. Maybe it's time to hire someone like yourself or someone like me or someone that has commercial experience to say, you know, I've got like 50 packages on my computer that you can use as templates. We're not recreating the wheel. We'll use one of these. We'll get proper photos, mapping. We're going to just dazzle them with information that anyone can get, you know, even a Google map of an overview of like an aerial view of the building. I mean, make a nice package. Like the first thing you do in commercial real estate, whether it's a duplex or a $50 million shopping mall, is you produce a package, right? Yeah. And then typically what happens going down the road is if there's an interest, usually you're going to sign an NDNC, which is quite common in commercial, an uncircumvention, non-disclosure, and then the agent can release the financial details of that property. Does that make sense, right? Like there's a procedure to it. You're not sending financials and rent rolls and leases out to anybody. There has to be a certain level of discretion there too, because how do you know they're not going to call your tenants and say, hey, we're building a new building down the street. If we build it, will you be interested in one of the units?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, I think there's so much place, especially in the smaller markets. You know, I take our two markets being quite similar. We have a little bit more population, but the lack of, or there's usually very few people that are well educated, that are professional, that they know their stuff in the multi-unit world. And whenever I have investors that call us, you know, I always make sure that I kind of guide them in the right direction to deal with somebody that's dealt with multi-units before. Because I know from a realtor standpoint, I've had friends that tried to dabble whether if it's residential multi-units, so four and under, even if it's a duplex or a triplex, or they've tried to get into something a little bit bigger, you know, they just get lost, and it's just a bad experience for everybody involved. You know, for the buyers, the sellers, it's just kind of a mess. So yeah. I think dealing, you know, I love dealing with somebody that has the experience and kind of knows what they're doing in that space.
Yeah. And you mentioned, I just wanted to touch on the gentleman from BC that was indicating that he had looked at the CMHC data for both New Brunswick and PEI, Moncton and Charlottetown, I think you said.
Yep.
The challenge we have in PEI or in some of the smaller provinces, I'm not sure if it's quite as pandemic in Moncton per se than it is in Charlottetown. We don't have enough data sometimes, and we've got owners of buildings that aren't releasing data to CMHC, so that the data pool is small. So when they look at CMHC and they say, you know, for instance, geez, I was looking at duplex sales and they're down by 50%, it might be because there's only five that sold rather than 10.
Right.
Or in Vancouver or Toronto or in the bigger cities across the states, there's a much bigger pool of information. So sometimes you need to disseminate that information. Additionally, Charlottetown's a much older city than Moncton. A lot of our buildings, our rentals, are older buildings. People don't want to be in those, right? And a lot of the owners aren't fixing them up. Yep. So it's not really a vacancy issue. They're moving to newer buildings, right? Those older buildings need to be fixed, and then people might want to rent them. In Moncton, you don't have that age of building, so the vacancy rate may look a little healthier, I would think. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, well, we just came out of 3 years of record growth in new construction. So Moncton did have a large inventory of older properties, exactly like you're saying for Charlottetown. However, now the market is just flooded with new material. And all the older buildings are kind of where the majority of the vacancy rates are at. The new buildings are doing quite well. Their rent rolls and their prices are lower than I think than what most of the owners would like. And they had to do that just because of the sheer competition. But we're now starting to get out of that. And 2016, I think, is the beginning of kind of an upswing in terms of getting our rent rolls back to where they should be. And it's either, you know, for the older buildings, they're at a point now where they're like, either you got to fix these buildings or you got to sell to somebody else that's going to fix them up to be able to rent them. Because if not, you're just not going to be able to survive this market.
No, absolutely. And the other thing is, you know, with owners wanting bigger rents, I ran into that situation myself with stuff I've owned. You raise the rents, you get tenants looking for other places to live. You keep the rents affordable, and they're there, you know, for 20 years or more. Yep. The other thing I found that I really caution buyers about is buildings are at the end of their life cycle. Mm-hmm. I see a number of people that call themselves apartment owners and builders. It's kind of an oxymoron, I would think. But they're building these apartments, and they're putting not a penny into them for 25 years, and they're putting them on the market at the end of that life cycle. And investors are coming along saying, oh, great, here's a 25 unit for sale. Little to know that even the carpet hasn't been changed and everything needs to be replaced. And we've had portfolios come up like that, and it's to the educated consumer or the educated agent or property manager buyer. You can spot this 20 miles away, but if you're not, you go in there, you think, oh, it's a 12 unit. Well, you don't need to know the furnace, the roof, the siding, the pavement, the windows, everything. The doors. Everything needs replacing, and that's why he's dumping it, and that's why he's called an apartment owner and builder, because he'll just take the money out and build a new one. Meanwhile, you're stuck with a major liability, because all these things, and it's the same with residential housing, have a life expectancy. If you're buying a house 25 years old, you better be paying a discount on that, because you're going to be doing a lot of work if that's you want to, you know, if that's the level you want to bring it up to.
Absolutely. Kind of very good timing. We're dealing with an owner right now. He's buying, I think it's 85 units here in town, divided by four buildings. And I won't say the current owner hasn't put any money into it. There's been some repairs done. However, I would say that 75% of the units still have, you know, older gray carpets, older kitchens, bathrooms haven't been touched. Windows haven't been touched. I think the roofs were done. I think that's probably the only CapEx that's been done over the last few years. So he's basically coming in and buying these units. Fortunately, he's getting them at a fantastic price. He's getting them, you know, for under 40 a unit. So he's going to come in, put all new windows, you know, redo some of the common areas, and then start taking care of all the vacancies and upgrading them. So, you know, maybe he puts $5,000-$10,000 a unit in the building. He's then got a great product for under $50,000 a unit that can rent out at, you know, $700 a month, which will provide a great return for him over time. So I think the key is getting the building at a right price. You can't have a building where it's 25 years old, it's at the end of its life cycle, and expect to get top dollar. That's a little tough.
Yeah, and that's absolutely true. And unless you're dealing with someone that's experienced that can disseminate that information and say, these are worth so much door. Or this is a good location, bad location. This is what's happening economically in the area. You know, you're sort of flying blind. I mean, you get a lot of inexperienced people buying apartments, and they're saying, "Well, I want a 6% cap, or I want a 10% cap, or 11." You can give them 40% cap, but that building's probably ready to fall down because it has so much deferred maintenance, and that's what's making that cap or simply is the return on the investment. You know, if you put money in a bank and you get 10%, that's sort of trying to compare, or it's supposed to be an equity to commercial investing to say you're getting a bigger return. But a bigger return typically is indicative of deferred maintenance. Yes. If you're getting a lower cap, like you're getting a 5 or 6, chances are that building's probably a newer building.
Yep.
So
absolutely.
The point I'm making is a bigger cap is not necessarily an indication of a better investment, in my opinion.
Yep. No, it's a great point. It's a great point. So where, kind of shifting gears, where do you see, what's your next investment? Where are you going in terms of your own personal investment in the next few years? Are you looking to acquire more rental? You're going to be focused more on land, commercial? How do you map things out within the next few years?
That's a very good question, and it certainly crosses my mind just about every day. I mean, being in commercial real estate, a lot of times you're sitting there saying, "Well, geez, I could flip this building out and make a couple dollars right now." But then once you make that money, the long term return is nothing because it's gone. So you get that money, and then you need to find new product.
Yep.
The way I typically work is, you know, you want to get enough equity in that building that you can release the charge on the properties that have the lien against them so that you can go out and buy more buildings. I mean, everyone that's done well in real estate has leveraged their equity. You know, they'll get that. The bank's looking for LTV. They're looking to loan-to-value ratio. They're going to say, if that building's worth $1 million, we want to see $200,000 in equity in it. So if you decide to throw in the keys or walk away or disappear, we can sell that building and we're not going to do it at a loss.
Right.
My biggest challenge, like any challenge, and this is why this really needs to be done to death in the form of a seminar, is just raising private capital. You know, at times I've thought of starting a REIT, but it's a little more involved, and I don't want to be chained to a desk 24 hours a day running a REIT. Yep. But being able to find the financial connections and the people that can provide that is completely instrumental in what you're trying to get accomplished, which is buying more buildings. And I think the other thing you have to get past as a professional investor, and I have this challenge a lot with people, is they look at debt as bad.
Credit card debt's
bad.
Yeah.
Student debt's bad. Going buying a car that depreciates 10 grand when you rent it off the lot, that's bad debt.
Yep.
But if I can buy, and this is being done every day, if you can buy a $1 million building with zero money down, or even some of your own cash, and it's bringing in $4,000 or $5,000 a month over and above paying that mortgage, and in the meantime, your tenants are paying off that mortgage, the market is escalating the price of the asset, so now you've got that advantage too, you're doing awesome. And if you want to, I don't do this, but you can depreciate those assets, so you have tax savings there as well, depending on what your exit strategy is. Anytime I look at property, and I get criticized for this, I'm more concerned about the exit than the entry. If I'm buying a house, or I'm buying an apartment, or a piece of land, I'm thinking, when I go to sell this, or when I want to get out of it, am I going to be able to get out? That's my only concern. I mean, I'm not going to buy something at top dollar, and in 5 years it's gone down in value just because it looked pretty from the road, right? I'm always looking at the exit strategy. It's like Monopoly, right? You know, you buy the house that turns into the, what is it, the hotel, or four houses in the hotel. That's the same thing with commercial real estate, because it's getting out of those houses. A lot of people will focus on the houses, but not think about, like, I can dump the houses and get a bigger building, which, of course, gets into another debate, which you may or may not want to get into, is what should you be buying? Single-family units, duplexes, triplexes, quads, two- and three-story 30 units. I mean, there's a lot of people I run into that have different beliefs as far as what you should buy. A lot of people say don't buy anything other than singles or duplexes because they're easier to liquidate than a 12 or a 25 unit. Would you agree with that?
Definitely. In terms of the liquidation factor, absolutely. In terms of my personal preference, I think the more doors under one roof, the better. So the bigger, the better. Just from, you know, from a management standpoint, from just being able to scale out, I've always preferred more units, the better. I'm not a huge fan of the single family duplex. Usually four would be the smallest that I would go. However, I'm not... I don't shun an eye to think that there's not any money to be made in those markets. I know a ton of guys that are doing extremely well, buying single family houses in fantastic neighborhoods, renting them out, working with JV partners, doing rent to owns. You know, there's so many different ways to make money in real estate. So I think it's really a preference in terms of what somebody wants to do. I think single family can be great for the right person. For me, I think it's more on the multi-unit side. Bigger the better.
I would agree 100%, and I've never been able to see a house or duplex cash flow. I just haven't. No. I mean, if you say $60 a month is cash flow, fine, but I know people that own 5-10 houses, and I mean, they're lucky to be able to go out and buy a case of beer at the end of the month, right? But their theory is their business plan, and I can understand it, is they're buying houses at hopefully under market values. They're fixing them up. Yeah. They're renting them out in 20, 25 years from now when they're paid off. Yeah. They'll have some cash or an income, which brings me to another point. I always try to cut my amortization down if it's part of the business plan. If I'm going to buy something, I want it paid off in 3 years, I'm not getting a 25-year mortgage, I'm getting a 10.
Right, okay. Yep.
Banks always try to get you into the 25, 30 because they make oodles and oodles of interest.
Of course.
Sometimes it's better to get that 10-year amortization. The other thing I also do is I also look at, and again, considering the exit strategy, what the balloon or bubble payments are too, right?
Yep.
A lot of banks, BMO, has plans where you can pay down 25% of the original mortgage value every year. So if you have increased cash flow, you have a good year, pay that mortgage down. Again, take the equity back out, put it into something else. It's so exciting. I mean, one of the questions I have for you is, I mean, you take a house that's $150,000, which would be pretty typical in PEI.
Yeah. Yep.
My equation is typically that you need 0.8. To 1% of that purchase price in rent to make that viable. So $1,500 a month, $1,200, $1,500 a month, which here is not easy to get. I don't know what you would use for an equation, whether it's a single door for $100,000 or it's 100 units at $100,000, the equation is the same. There has to be a net multiple or net percentage multiple of the purchase price. Would you agree or disagree with that?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I get calls. I don't want to say too regular investors that are looking at the market here in Moncton, and they're looking at a duplex, or they're looking at one half of a semi, and they're calling themselves, you know, this is their first investment, or their experienced investors or whatever. My first thing, I was like, why on earth would you go and buy that? You're going to pay, like you said, probably around $150,000 to $170,000 for, let's say, a semi-detached or a detached bungalow. That's probably a good price in the Moncton market. I'm only going to be able to rent that thing out for probably $1,200 or $1,300 a month. So by the time you pay your property, your mortgage, in New Brunswick, we're so lucky that we're double taxed in property taxes here, that on a $150,000 house, you're going to be paying $4,000 to $5,000 a year in property taxes. So that alone usually just kind of throws everything out in the water. If they do decide and to buy that type of property with after property management fees and all the carrying costs, they're usually lucky to break even. And most of them will usually be in a negative position at the end of the day. Not my idea of real estate investing. I like to have, you know, obviously healthy cash flow. I'm looking for appreciation. I'm looking for mortgage pay down. But, you know, cash flow is a huge part of the equation, right?
Yeah, and you mentioned something there. Maybe I misheard you, but you indicated that the property taxes increase for out-of-province owners. Was that what you said?
No, in New Brunswick, we're the only province in Canada to where rental properties are double taxed. We have a municipal and a provincial property tax.
Wow.
So that's for everybody. I know PEI is different. It's only for out of province investors. But here, if I have semi that I'm paying, let's say the average rate would be around $2,400 per year property taxes on a brand new semi-detached $180,000 house. If I go and rent that out as a secondary home, I'll be paying closer to $5,000 a year in taxes.
Well, I've never heard of that. We don't have double taxation in PEI.
Yeah. Yeah.
What we have is, if let's say your property taxes were $1,000 a year, what you have is, if you're a resident,
right,
then you would receive a 30% discount.
Right.
And you're touching on something there too that I'm sure you address as a really good property manager. Is it's important to make sure that you're not overassessed either, right? If I'm buying a door, let's just call it a door, whether it's a house or a 50 unit apartment building, but it's costing me $100,000 a door, I want to make sure my tax assessment isn't 125,000.
Yep.
Because the tax computers are overzealous, right? They just want to keep pushing those taxes up and up and up.
I was on a call yesterday with Altus. We're reviewing our entire portfolio. Property tax season is right around the corner, so every year I send them my complete list of all my properties, and they review everything. I think last year we won close to 50 cases in terms of some instances. We had a bunch of townhouses, row houses, condos. They were assessed at $80,000. However, the last two sales were $30,000 bank repos. The market was just awful. We got them all reassessed. This was 43 condos. We got them all reassessed at 50. So I saved all my owners probably around $800 a year in taxes.
Yeah, no, that's brilliant. And I did the same thing. I actually wrote an article on it a couple of years ago because the tax rates were escalating phenomenally. And I was looking at properties, and this was one 2 weeks ago. It was out of line by 264%.
Wow.
You know, they're paying like almost triple of what they should have been. So now I offer service to my clients that I will do the research for them, sort of the same thing you're paying Altus to do. Altus would probably do a much better job because that's what they do every day.
Yeah.
But I offered as a free service to get their taxes down. And when I did mine, I did about a half a dozen different properties. And I got like 50% discounts. I got one reduced by $110,000 a year, which would be what?
Wow.
$400 or $500 a year in taxes.
Yeah.
It added up to a lot of money. So it's important to keep an eye on those assessment values. And the other point I wanted to make is when you receive financial information or you look at an MLS cut sheet, normally, a lot of times, there's no indication where that property tax number comes from. It could be out of date. It could be a resident. It could be non-resident. So it's best to probably get the print out off the tax computer itself. Because if you're trying to work out a financial plan and your taxes are another $8,000 a year, that sort of affects the bottom line. And a lot of provinces and states do have special rules for out-of-province or out-of-state buyers. And when I talked about bad debt and good debt, the other thing I've had is I had a conversation a couple of weeks ago, again, from someone from D.C., and they said they wanted to buy an apartment and pay cash. And I kept trying to convince them that, like, you're not going to earn anything on that. You're going to make like 4%, whereas if you could take that money and leverage it, you might make 10 or 15.
Yeah.
He was adamant on not having the debt, which I completely respect. From a financial standpoint, if you can borrow money for next to nothing, then why not do it as long as it's a viable investment? And that's the interesting thing, right, is the bank, as much as we like to say good things or bad things about banks, banks will not typically get involved with transactions that are bad for them. And that's why you can't typically borrow money for stocks or bonds or options or futures, because they're so volatile. But getting money to buy real estate, the banks love. Because typically, especially in Canada, it's such a great investment. And we've never seen what happened in the States and in parts of Europe where the bubble exploded. Our real estate may not go up 300% per annum, but it's certainly never gone down to zero, right?
Exactly. Yep. No, that's a great point. That's a great point. Yep. All right. So let me, we went through a ton of awesome material here. I think you've provided a lot of good insights to give our investors out there. At the end of the day, I think it's all about, you know, going back to this whole binder and presentation and dealing with realtors and dealing with brokers and all this thing, right? We must never forget that real estate investing is a relationship business. And I say that on every series that we have with different investors that come on the show. We're in the relationship business, whether if it's building relationships with your realtors, your property managers, your brokers, your bankers, insurance agents, all those people, right? The people that look at being a real estate investor from a professional standpoint will do, you know, 1,000 times better than those that approach it in very much an amateur-like behavior. So go out there and get the education that's needed. I'm a big fan of RAIN. That's the Canadian Real Estate Investment Network. They have some great books out there that shows you how to prepare your investor binder, how to deal and how to present and how to the whole buying process of multi-units or, you know, whatever type of investment that you're looking for. There's a lot of tools out there. And, you know, Michael, I thank you for kind of, you know, you've shown a lot of great points in terms of what people should be aspiring to be and how to deal with these different vendors. I don't know if you had any parting tips, any last words you'd like to speak out there. And also, how can people reach you? How can people find you? I know you're huge on YouTube. You're always on Facebook. So what would be the main point of contact for people to reach you if they're looking at possibly doing something in the Charlottetown or in the PEI?
My main website's michaelshomes.com, michaelshomes.com, or just call me at 902-626-6912. And I really appreciate you having me on, Tony. It went better than I thought. At the beginning, I was asking Tony if we could edit things 100 different times to make them look good at the end of this session, but they seem to have turned out reasonably well.
Absolutely.
The tips I have, we talked about before we went on air, is when approaching an agent looking for commercial property, don't act like you're doing them this massive favor that, oh, this agent now has me as a buyer. The fact is, a successful agent probably has 100 times more buyers than he can deal with, and he's probably either ignoring them or passing them off or referring them to somebody else. If you're serious about dealing with a good commercial agent, meet with them. Go for lunch, talk to them about your goals, go over what you own now, have your financing in place. That agent will take you a lot more serious than the calls I get are, you know, someone sticking their head in my car there a few days ago saying, oh yeah, we'd like to see that 20 units. Like, you know, I don't want to, if I have someone looking to sell an apartment, I want to do this professionally, and I want to make sure that if I'm going to inconvenience 20 tenants, I want to make sure that they are a qualified purchaser. In the past, I've had agents where I've said, you know, what are you looking for? And they'll tell me, I'm looking for a 25 unit in this cap, this location with a garage, two bedroom, this old, this design. Mm-hmm. And you show it to them. And then, well, what happened to the buyer? Mm-hmm. If it fit all their needs, why didn't they buy? Because there's something missing from the equation. There's just a funny story. There's one broker that probably moves more commercial apartments than anybody else in the entire country. And the way he works is he takes a $10,000 deposit on the initial meeting, and he says, either I find you what you're looking for or you get the money back. So in other words, he has some money that says, this guy's serious, this guy's qualified, he's ready to buy, I got his check for 10 grand. So if I find him what he's looking for and he doesn't buy it, at least I've, you know, I haven't spent 6 months doing working for nothing. Because as agents, we're paid on commission only. I don't have a salary. If I don't sell something, I don't get paid. Whereas a lot of clients think, I get paid all day just to drive around, look at buildings, walk up and down the street, taking pictures. You get paid for performance. Yep. And when you do that, it's really important that you know that your purchasers are serious. Just in respect to the vendors and the people living in the building. I mean, if you're a tenant in the building, you don't want people going through it six times a week. Well, that's basically it. The other thing I have is I have a quick spreadsheet. I'm sure you have one. I type in a bunch of numbers. It shoots out the results, and I find that can probably assess an apartment instantaneously. The only thing I don't have, and this is what I rely on people like you for, is a lot of times I will bring property managers into it to say, here's a building. It's completely mismanaged. The guy has 12 other businesses going. What can we turn this into? You know, because right now it's not performing. And the advantage of an unperforming building is I can pick it up for nothing. Because if it was performing, it would probably be worth double. What you can is you have to wonder why someone wouldn't hire someone like you to say, go in there, clean the building up, make it performing. And then when we go to sell it, we'll get twice as much money or more money for it. So thanks very much, Tony. Anytime. Just I'm glad you you contacted me. It's been a lot of fun, and I learned a lot.
Awesome. That's great. Thanks so much, Michael. I appreciate you coming on. So again, everybody, we appreciate you for tuning in today. Michael's information will be provided within the descriptions of the video, which we'll be posting on our Facebook page, so Ground Floor Academy through Facebook, and also on YouTube. You just got to search for Ground Floor Academy. And it's been great. And we'll be chatting again soon. All right. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks very much.